You're strapped in to a live radio broadcast on Pure Rock Radio.
Welcome to the used bin. All music, all the time. What are you listening to? Used Bin Radio.
Welcome to the Used Bin, ladies and gentlemen.
It's another Tuesday night. It is Used Bin Radio. My name is Brad Hirsch. I'm a Virgo. I'm 6'10", and I enjoy sex.
My name is Joe Mama, and I'm just a rock and roll legend.
In his own mind.
In my own mind.
That's right.
And in your mom's.
No, in your mind.
Okay.
Just your mind.
Okay.
Hey, thanks for hanging out with us on this lovely Tuesday night, unless, of course, you live here in California in the San Fernando Valley, where it's pretty much on fire.
Yeah.
And in which case, I hope you're hanging out inside safe and sound and ready to rock and roll and listen to a little Used Bin Radio.
And not making an ash of yourself.
That's right.
Yeah.
We have a great show planned for you tonight. We have lots of stuff going on. Lots and lots has happened in the last week.
We've been to some big shows in the last few days. Yeah. We're going to bring you up to speed on that, in particular Prog-Nation.
And we have a big interview for you tonight.
Yes.
Legendary LEXXI
FOXX.
LEXXI FOXX of STEEL PANTHER will join us. He's the bass player of the biggest rock and roll band known to man.
Indeed. Indeed.
Right.
They are the carrying the torch for arena rock everywhere, and he's going to grace our presence with his metalness.
Right, we're going to get to that, I would say, in about 30 or 40 minutes or so. But in the meantime,
We also would like to welcome some of our new listeners, because we made some cute new friends down at the Prog-Nation show. Some people from all over the country, actually, who flew in because it was the last night of the Prog-Nation tour for Dream Theater and ZAPPA and all those kids. And so welcome. Welcome, new listeners.
Right. And if you guys, if you're all listening tonight and you want to call and participate, give us your review of the show, or just talk about a little bit about what you've been listening to, you can call us at 310-840-4438 or hit us up on the email at usedbinradio@usedbin.com. And again, we want to hear your reviews of the show, what you guys have been listening to, and around what's going on.
I also want to throw out a quick happy birthday to Doug Starr. Doug Starr of the other 80s iconic band from the Sunset Strip, Dr. Starr, who after all these years, after 25-something years, are finally going to have a CD coming out pretty soon, and we're going to keep you up to date about that as it gets closer. But Doug's birthday, we got together with Doug over the weekend, and that was good fun,
right.
And watched some archival footage of Dr. Starr at the Whiskey on videotape.
All right.
And so that was good fun.
Very good.
But other than the big shows...
Yes, sir.
What have you been listening to, brother man?
Well, let's see. I'll tell you what I've been listening to. I listened to... Have you heard this band, Cage the Elephant?
No, I have not.
Cage the Elephant.
Are they a prog band?
No.
Because that name sounds like, you know, Helmet of Gnats or...
There's not enough lightning and fairies and elves and dreams
for
and
them
clouds.
To, for them
and,
to be a prog band?
Yeah.
Ah.
Unfortunately. But this band is very cool. They are kind of like a... Well, if you remember last week, I was talking about the new Arctic Monkeys record.
Right.
And
right.
I said that it didn't feel, it felt like a very mature Arctic Monkeys, which I didn't really love. I was kind of bummed out. I missed that immaturity. I missed the sort of punk rockedness.
That's right. We talked about the punk rockedness,
right.
Because here on Used Bin Radio, you get a linguistics lesson.
That's right.
All right.
Well, Cage the Elephant sort of is the punk rockedness of the Arctic Monkeys,
okay.
Which is pretty cool. So I don't know a ton about them. Somebody gave me the record. I listened to it. I listened to it about 4 or 5 times. Really a good, cool record. So it's got that Arctic Monkeys feel to it, where it's a little bit frantic and a little bit kooky going on. But the songs are really good. It feels a little immature-ish. It feels a little all over the place, which I like. And it was really great. So it's a really good record. And so I spent most of the week with that. And besides the normal... rock and roll shows that we went to, which we'll get into in a little bit. But the only other big news in my life is is little Babalu, which is my baby that's coming.
Little Babalu.
Yes, up until the day he's born, his name is Babalu. And we saw Babalu yesterday.
Babalu Cygnus Hirsch.
That's right.
Okay.
Babalu was rocking out yesterday. We did the big ultrasound, the big 4D ultrasound, so we saw his little ass, and it was pretty cool.
Nice.
Yeah. Fist clenched and ready to fight. So that's how we knew it was my kid, I guess.
Nice.
Yeah, and that's really it, man. That's been it. What about you? What are you listening to?
Well, we talked about last week how I'm, pretty much the optimist.
Mm-hmm.
Let me get something off my chest here. Let me get something off my chest that I'm pissed off about.
Okay.
I'm pissed. I'm upset. Here in Los Angeles, and I'm not going to mention the name of the show because I just don't think they deserve the credit. But here in Los Angeles, if you don't have satellite radio on your alarm clock, you listen to pretty much the only rock station left. And like I said, I'm not going to plug them. But the morning show out here pisses me off because these are supposed to be rock and roll DJs doing the morning shtick here in LA. And these two clowns know nothing about music, and it really upsets me. So the other day, I'm listening to these two guys, morning radio. I wake up to them, and their topic for the morning is, what's their favorite album of all time? Fair enough. Okay, a couple of rock guys talking about music. You and I can relate to that.
Sure.
All right, but here's what these two clowns have to say. First of all, one of them says, well, if I had to pick one album, I'd have to go with the Rolling Stones' Exile on Main Street. Fair enough.
Sure.
But his logic was, because I can't live without the song Gimme Shelter. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but Gimme Shelter's not on that album.
I'm going to go with a no on that.
So that was bonehead maneuver number one.
Absolutely.
And then the other guy chimes in and says, well, if I had to pick one album, I'd probably have to go Neil Diamond, Hot August Night, Live at the Hollywood Bowl.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Number two.
Because that wasn't at the Hollywood Bowl. It was at the Greek Theater. So anyway, I was pissed off. These guys upset me. Every morning, they open their mouth and their brains fall out.
But they're big list guys, and we are the antithesis of list guys.
That's true.
We hate lists.
That's true. So moving right along. So other than that, you know what I've been listening to a lot of? No lie. I've been listening to a lot of the new Steel Panther.
Okay.
And I've got the Feel the Steel CD here in my hand, which to you civilians, you won't be able to get it until October 6th. But I have an advance copy because we're industry people.
All right.
We got connections.
What industry? We're not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. But you're going to need to all check this out because it could be the greatest metal record of all time.
Okay.
And songs on here like Death to All But Metal and Asian Hookers and The Girl from Oklahoma and Hell's on Fire. I mean, this is a rocking little record. So like we mentioned earlier, we're going to have LEXXI FOXX from Steel Panther on the show a little bit later tonight to talk about the legendary history of this band. But I've been listening to that record a lot and really rocking out to it.
Absolutely.
Other than that, it's really just been about all the great shows that we've been going to the last few days.
Should we jump right in?
Let's jump right in.
All right.
Last Thursday night, I was at the legendary Viper Room on Sunset Boulevard. And I went to see one of the most smoking hot rock shows that I've seen in a while. Now, you know I'm a big fan of the Wild Hearts.
Right.
Well,
I have to tell you, I can't identify with.
Really?
I'm not a big Wild Hearts fan.
Surprises me because they got big monster hooks, but serious riffs, and they're angry.
And
you usually love angry.
Yeah, I do like angry, but it just sort of sounds, it's not angry enough, the riffs aren't quite big enough, and the hooks aren't quite big enough for me.
Maybe a little later tonight I'll play a Wild Hearts song that might sway you.
I think you're going to play a Wild Hearts
song. Yeah, I think I probably will. So when Ginger, the lead singer of the Wild Hearts, comes out to L.A. and decides to do a pretty much secret show. I mean, there wasn't a lot of hype about this. I remember they came out about 2 years ago and I went to see him, and it was a big deal, and they played a bigger venue. But the Viper Room's pretty small, so when they decided to do this, and it was a relatively hush-hush kind of thing, we found out about it last minute, and me and a buddy went down there, went into the club, and the first surprise of the night was we got in just as the opening band was going on, and surprise of surprises, it was the reunited Jet Boy. who I haven't seen since like 1988.
Right.
And they broke out into Feel the Shake, and Mickey Finn still has the mohawk, and they rocked pretty hard. They sounded pretty tight after all these years. I got to say, I was really impressed, and it was a treat to see him just because it's Jet Boy.
Sure.
And you know, that was value added for my $10 admission.
That's all it was.
$10 is $10. That's all it was.
Well, that's a cheap ticket.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, good.
So then Ginger comes out to do his Wild Heart set, and he comes out wearing a kilt, which is, you know, that's always good for fun. And this was a sweaty, stinky rock show. And from the opening notes, they were just powering through, you know, the best of the Wild Hearts. A couple of highlights were Sucker Punch, Greetings from Shitsville, and I Want to Go Where the People Go. So they were rocking pretty hard.
Right.
And as they were going through the set, at some point, this was sort of a weird twist, actually, for Ginger, because he's usually kind of that angry English rock star guy. And he sort of had like this mellow moment where he was talking about how he's trying to keep a real positive mental attitude these days, and it's so nice to be chilled out in Los Angeles and the sunshine with all you beautiful people.
And the fires.
And the fire. Well, this was before the fires.
Right.
But
and now we know who's responsible.
He was saying, so he's keeping a positive mental attitude and just talking about music with his friends and talking about stuff that he really loves and really really appreciates. And he was talking to some guy in the studio the other day while he was recording some stuff here in L.A. about one of the bands that really influenced him and a band that he loved back in the 70s, a band called Stars. Do you remember Stars?
No.
They had a couple of great albums, Coliseum Rock, which is a great album title.
Sure.
They had another one called Violation, which is sort of their masterwork, if you will. And this was a band that used to be sort of in the thick of things right when Kiss and Angel and that whole sort of Casablanca glam thing was going on. And Stars were a great band. They had a great prototype of a lead singer, Michael Lee Smith, who was just a rock god back in the 70s. Anyway, Ginger at the Wild Heart show is talking about how he was trying to turn people on to this band that he loved. And the guy he was talking to in the studio actually said, I know those guys. In fact, I engineered one of their early records. Do you want to talk to him? And Ginger was like, oh, totally. Talk to my heroes? Absolutely. So he started chatting with Michael Lee Smith, the old lead singer from Stars. And he turned up at the Viper Room. And Ginger ended up bringing him up on stage. And they rocked pretty hard. So that was a nice little treat.
It's fun.
And then toward the end of the show, he had one more surprise up his sleeve. And he was talking about all the great songs that he'd wished he'd written over the years. And one of them was Rebel Yell, which he thought was one of the great, great rock songs of the 80s.
Okay.
And he brought Steve Stevens up. And they did just a shredding version of Rebel Yell and rocked the place. And it was just a, like I said, a big, stinky, sweaty rock show.
I like Steve Stevens.
Yeah.
He's a great guitar player.
And he wears a lot of makeup.
Well, he would too if you were 300 years old. You know what I mean?
Indeed. Yeah. Indeed.
But Steve Stevens is a great guitar player. Underrated guitar player.
Yeah,
because
I would agree.
He was overshadowed by Billy Idol.
Yeah.
And he's a monster all on his own.
Yeah.
For sure.
I would agree. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did a fine job. So, Wild Hearts, Ginger, check him out.
Nice.
Good stuff. And then I went to the other side of the musical spectrum, and this is where my where I show you that I have no testicles whatsoever.
Yes.
I have nuts the size of raisins. We were going to take a friend of ours for her birthday to the Hollywood Bowl over the weekend to go see Liza Minnelli. Wait, it gets worse. At the very last minute, she bailed because she had to fly back home to Boston.
And you went anyway, right?
And we went anyway.
Oh, God.
So here we are having wine and cheese, watching Liza Minnelli. And I got to say that she's whacked.
She's fucking nuts.
She's insane. She's lost her mind. She was fully medicated. Just,
of course she was.
Just Looney Tunes. At one point, before she went into like the big show-stopping version of New York, New York, she was talking about how her Uncle Frank used to do this song. And it takes you a minute to realize she's actually talking about Sinatra.
Yeah.
But what was really strange was when I was really paying attention to what she was saying it present tense. Like, I really don't think she knows that her Uncle Frank is dead. I think she's really, like, lost in this other world. And people in the audience would shout out, like, we love you, Liza. And she would, like, get all serious and be like, oh, I really love you. And this song is dedicated to you because it's a very important song to me, and I love you all.
God.
She was sort of like...
I fucking hate
She was like the drag queen version of Ozzy in that way. She was just a little nuts. And then, of course, she ended with the big cabaret. And when she's doing cabaret, you had, like, drag queens out in the audience with boas on and doing, like, their whole Rocky Horror choreography. It was a scene, man. It was a whole scene. We had a situation going
on. That's a rough go.
At the Hollywood Bowl.
Yeah, that's a rough go of it. I don't know that you could drag me to the Hollywood Bowl to see Liza Minnelli.
But would you go and drag to see Liza Minnelli?
I would go anywhere and drag.
Okay. Sure. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, no, I'm good with the drag.
Nothing wrong with a little bow and on then.
No.
Little Aquanet.
I'm down with the drag.
Okay.
Totally down with the drag. All right, but let's get into what really matters here. Let's get into the meat and potatoes of the weekend, young man.
Prog-Nation.
Yes. Let's read a little email.
We got an email from a new listener. New listener, Rosemary in Florida. And she flew all the way in from Florida for the LA show. She says, for starters, I live in Florida, and I was at the show in Los Angeles. That's how much I love Dream Theater. I also had a ticket to be in the pit. So I was right in front of John Petrucci,
nice.
which is very cool. And we had pretty decent seats ourselves. So
sure.
if we had known in advance, we probably could have spotted her because we were just a few rows behind John Petrucci. So she says, since this was the last show of this leg of the tour, I wanted to be there knowing, and she's right, knowing that the last night of the tour usually means last show hijinks. And there was hijinks, which we'll talk about in a minute. To me, Dream Theater can do no wrong, and this was one of the best shows I've seen. She also mentions how beautiful the Greek Theater is, which I would agree. It's one of the finer venues we got here. Beautiful,
for sure.
Beautiful setting.
Probably my favorite venue in LA.
Yeah, beautiful setting in the mountains with the Hollywood Hills behind you.
There's not much that's wrong with the Greek, except for
it doesn't have a rock and roll vibe, though.
Well, it shouldn't, though.
No,
the Greek's not there. The Greek was never there for rock.
The Greek is where you go see James Taylor. The Greek is where you go see Neil Diamond.
That's not my issue with the Greek, though. Yeah. My issue with the Greek is two things. One is there's a noise curfew because it's in a residential area,
right? So
it's nestled way up there in the Hollywood Hills, sort of by the for everyone who doesn't know, by the Griffith Park Observatory. So it's really beautiful up there,
right?
But there is a sound curfew
because that's residential area,
right? And so the second thing is that they can't turn it up very loud. So besides the fact that they got to cut the power at a certain time, they can't crank the volume. So you're there for a rock show, but it's not very loud. You can sort of have a conversation with your buddy next to you and hear him pretty clearly. Like, I could hear the guys behind us having a conversation, and
right.
we were in the fourth row. So I do have an issue with that, with the Greek. But if you're there to see, you know, like you said, a James Taylor, obviously Neil Diamond, or Crosby, Stills, and Nash, or something in that vein, then it's good. Then that's the perfect place to see him.
Or Liza Minnelli.
No.
In drag.
You should never see Liza Minnelli in drag. But I'm sorry. So finish the email. I'm sorry.
So then she just goes on to say, the Greek was a beautiful place. It was my first time there. Because you drive up the hill through the residential area of beautiful houses. And when you get up to the top of the hill, there's an incredible view of the city. Which there is.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
So... So, Rosemary in Florida, thanks for listening. Glad you enjoyed the show. We're going to give you our take, but if you were there, or if you caught him anywhere on this tour, give us a call. We would love to hear your review. We're at 310-840-4438, or drop us an email at usedbinradio@usedbin.com, ladies and gentlemen.
That's right. So, let us know what you think.
So what did you think?
All right, let's get into the
let's start with
the beginning of the night.
Okay.
So there's four bands on the bill, right? We have Scale the Summit, we have Big Elf, we have Zappa Play Zappa, and we have Dream Theater.
Dream Theater history.
So I remember last year at Prog-Nation,
which was indoors for us in LA, which had a whole different vibe.
Mm-hmm, the whole bill was a lot more metal.
It was a lot more
but
like Snowy would have liked it more last year because it was a little bit more growly, a little Cookie Monster-esque, if you will.
For me, always been my issue with Prog-Nation, the last two Prog-Nations, have been that it feels like a Dream Theater show with three openers. It doesn't feel like a celebration of progressive rock.
Yeah.
And I've always had a problem with that. And it's not even, it's sort of like just the lack of signage that says Prog-Nation.
Right.
And I mean, I know what Mike Portnoy is trying to do. I get it. You know, we're trying to promote progressive rock.
Right.
And all elements of progressive rock, whether it's progressive metal, you know, whether it's a little more symphonic prog, whether it's classic prog, neo-prog, whatever it is that you want to call it. This is a celebration of progressive rock. And it's sort of, like I said, it feels like a dream theater show.
Right.
Now, I'm definitely not opposed to going to a dream theater show, that's for sure.
Right.
You know, because God knows we've been to our share of dream theater shows.
Right.
So, anyway, so starting with Scale of the Summit, let's talk about them
first. Okay,
so these guys are four-piece. Right. 15-year-old kids, got to be. Okay,
right.
Maybe not 15, but they
but
sure
young,
look like.
Young kids, maybe 18, 20 years old.
Yeah, they were really good.
Instrumental four-piece.
Instrumental prog. And, one of these kids comes out who looks like he's got to be 14 years old, comes out playing a 12-piece electric guitar, or a 12-string electric guitar.
The kid with that sort of wavy blonde haircut that looked like he was the kid on your little league team.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that was good.
And he played.
They were great. They were really good. I was surprised actually at how good they were because you and I had never heard them before. And so I really enjoyed them. I thought, you know, it's tough to come in and just do an instrumental prog set because prog, especially if it's sort of metalish prog, I think it all starts to sound the same a little bit after a while.
Right.
It's sort of the melody that takes it in a different direction. But I thought these kids really, they did great. I thought they really kicked ass. This had to have been the biggest gig of their life this last month.
Oh, absolutely.
And I thought they really played well.
Yeah, monstrous chops. Like I said, it was all instrumental. A little bit of a Rush influence maybe at times. And nice 12-string guitar going on through some of the set, and just serious prog. One thing that I thought was really cute about Scale the Summit, whereas all the other bands, you know, were hawking their wares and selling t-shirts and posters or whatever, these guys were selling tablature books of all the notes of their guitar parts, which you would, you know, be curious who would actually buy something like that.
It's instrumental prog.
But people were buying it, and I love that.
Sure.
Wait, hang on a second. Little Marillion,
right?
Little Marillion.
I did that for you.
I appreciate it.
Yeah, well, you know, I try to take care of you, Pally.
I like it.
So next up was Big Elf.
Big Elf with the big hat.
Right. Mad Hatter.
The Mad Hatter, yes.
What'd you think?
I didn't love them. I thought on record they sounded a little better. They're a little bit more symphonic, a little more harmonic, a little bit more interesting. Live, they came off as sort of like a proggy version of Black Sabbath, which is not a bad thing, but it was a little meandering, I thought, at times. And the singer, unfortunately, was probably blown out from having done three consecutive shows. And I don't think their stage show and their particular dark, mysterious persona lends itself to playing in 90 degree heat at the Greek Theater in Southern California
in the middle of the day
at 6 o'clock. Yeah. You know, in daylight.
There was an issue too. I think that the fact that they had such a small
penis?
Such a small stage. Such a small area to play. I mean, they really were cut off there. I mean, there's bigger stages and clubs.
Yeah.
So I thought they were really sort of cut off. And what was interesting about them is the singer is, you know, he's got his Hammond organ and he's got his other little organ right on the other side of him. And that's the centerpiece of the show. And, you know, the guitar player and bass player are next to him and the drummer behind him. But he's the focus of the show. And with such a small stage, there wasn't much for him to do. It's not like he could kind of get out and move around and be the character that I think that they are. So I'm really looking forward to seeing them open for Porcupine Tree next month.
Yeah.
Actually, this month now, I guess, in the next couple of weeks. I think that'll be indoors in a club. It'll be more their vibe.
Yeah, I agree.
But I really dig their songs. I'm with you, though. I didn't think they were great when we saw them, and I think that has a lot to do with it being the last night of the tour, blown out from the third night of three in a row. And but I thought they were really good. I really like that band. I think the songs are great. To me, they're like a proggy Alice Cooper.
Yeah.
That's what they remind me of.
Interesting to see what they come up with in future years.
Yeah, no, I think they're really good. Very, very good.
Which brings us to Zappa Plays Zappa, which I know both you and I, and I think a lot of people in the crowd were really anticipating and were really looking forward to, because
they were curious.
Yeah, a lot of the Dream Theater crowd probably had never seen or really even been exposed to a lot of Zappa. I think it's not obvious, whereas, you know, Opeth from last year is an obvious crossover.
The young kids don't know,
right.
Don't know a lot of Zappa. The young kids are into, you know, Shadows Fall and Opeth.
Yeah.
That sort of deal.
Which, interesting you mentioned that real quick. I should probably mention something you guys could look forward to in the coming weeks on the up-and-coming Usebin site when we finally launch it. We have a Usebin Radio YouTube station, which you could go check out. And sometime in the not-too-distant future, we're going to get some clips up there, because we raided the parking lot prior to the Prog-Nation show, and we interviewed a bunch of kids and a bunch of fans, and talked to them about Dream Theater and Prague, and it was interesting to see what some of the bands were that the fans were into.
Yeah.
A lot of the same names kept popping up.
Sure.
We were also asking people like what songs they were most looking forward to hearing, and it was interesting how across the board, pretty much, Count of Tuscany was like the most anticipated song. Everybody was really hoping they did that.
It's the biggest song on this record, on Black Clouds and Silver Linings. And it's by far, I mean, that's like,
that's the,
you know, when Octavarium was the, Octavarium's the masterpiece of Octavarium, Count of Tuscany is the masterpiece piece of this record.
And although we'll get to Dream Theater in just a couple more minutes here, I'll bury the lead here and tell you, yes, they played Count of Tuscany. So we'll get to that in a moment. But Zappa Plays Zappa. So we were anticipating the show.
It's very exciting.
It was very exciting, and they came out, and they did not disappoint.
No, I mean, that band is, they were unbelievable.
Just silly chops. These guys are too good.
Yeah, it was, I mean, I was blown away. I half expected it to be great, because I've heard some of the live stuff that they've done, that Dweezil's done in the last couple years when he's toured this. But the set's been changing every night, so we have no clue what they were going to play. And, you know, for this kind of crowd, I didn't know if they were going to tailor this to more of the, more of the Mothers era of Zappa.
Mothers of Invention.
Or were they going to be a little bit more silly?
Yeah, you know, they could have easily done, Frank's comedy, comedy rock.
Or were they just going to go in a completely nutty prog way? And I think they did a little bit of everything.
A little bit of everything.
And it was really exciting.
Crowd-pleasing set. I'll give you some highlights from the set list for those of you who did not get to see it. They pulled out some of the Zappa classics like Apostrophe, Bamboozled by Love. They did Black Page, which is the most ridiculous drum instrumental ever created.
Black Page number one.
And they did Valley of the Sun, Pound for a Brown, and then they brought out Mike Portnoy as a special guest.
Yeah.
And he sat in with them for a classic little version of Broken Hearts Are for Assholes.
And Mike is a self-described Zappa fanatic. He's made it known on more than one occasion that he is that Zappa is one of his biggest musical influences.
Yeah.
So, and I've heard too, I know earlier in the tour he came out and he played with them, but he's just made it real clear that this was the biggest treat for him to bring Dweezil and to bring that band out on tour with them. And he's been watching every show apparently from the side of the stage.
He actually, just to backtrack for a second, he also came out during the Big Elf set, and he played drums on Big Elf's song Black Ball.
Right.
So in a way, this was almost sort of like the Mike Portnoy party, because it was
the
like all these...
Prog-Nation is Mike Portnoy's
party. It is. It was like all these bands were playing his party, and especially the fact that it was the last night of the tour. He was just popping out all over the place, and there was all kinds of weird shtick going on where, you know, he would have like an Easter Bunny walk out during one of the band's set.
Yeah.
Or at one point he had like a bunch of road crew come out with Star Wars costumes, and they had like a lightsaber battle.
Right.
So that was great. And that brings us to the headline attraction.
Let's save Dream Theater.
Okay, let's save Dream Theater. You want to take a little break and bring back the legendary LEXXI FOXX of STEEL PANTHER. We're going to get on the line in just a couple of minutes.
Right.
How about we go to a little Dream Theater right now?
Peruvian Skies.
How about that?
Okay.
We'll do a little live version of Peruvian.
And then we'll come back with LEXXI FOXX of STEEL PANTHER. Send us your emails, usebinradio@usebin.com. If you have a question for LEXXI, I'm sure we could ask him that. Or if you want to talk about Dream Theater or anything else we've been discussing. And we will be right back with LEXXI FOXX.
Mm-hmm. The year was 1985. The place, Hollywood, California. The band?
STEEL PANTHER was absolutely groundbreaking.
STEEL PANTHER kicks ass.
Great on stage, great music. They had it all going on.
These guys are rock and roll. I mean, they set the tempo for what we all do.
Yeah, I mean, whatever happened to those assholes?
What happened to those assholes, indeed? From the sordid streets of Hollywood, four brash and not too bright young men came together to form the greatest metal band you never heard. This is a story of heavy metal dreams, wasted days, and a destiny finally fulfilled 20 years later. This is STEEL PANTHER, Behind the Music.
Hey, welcome back to the Used Bin. It's Brad Hirsch, it's Joe Mama with you, and you just heard the beginning of the Behind the Music for the legendary STEEL PANTHER, and we are lucky enough to have on the line with us the bass player for the legendary STEEL PANTHER, Mr. LEXXI FOXX. How are you, LEXXI?
Hey, I'm doing awesome. How are you guys doing?
Outstanding. Thanks for joining us in the Used Bin. You know,
sure.
The two of us were lucky enough to catch your show last night, and hey, there were a lot of boobies there.
Yep, there were tons of boobies there, and I want to tell you now, I don't know, how long are you going to be on, how long do you guys work? Is this a bitching party that I'm going to? See, the kids are, you know that show, our Hollywood show, is 18 and over, so I get a chance to meet a lot of kids, you know, and some of the kids have fake IDs, so but they're going back to school, so we're having one big blowout, and it's going to be fucking bitching, because they start school, and it's my last chance to hook up. With a hot little with, but you know what's bitching is the moms that are gonna be at this party are gonna be amazing. So
of course,
if you get off the air, I'm gonna tell you what it is. It's Tap High School. I guess they're having their go back to school party, whatever the fuck. But dude, some of the moms that are there, the kids are bitching. You know, the kids are already, you know, and that rules. And the little girls, their vaginas are so just tiny and little and not working. So anyway, it's bitching because I'll roll up with a couple of my bros and they got a kegger, I guess, there. And,
right.
And it's awesome.
That's
so
a Taft High School?
I'm going to head over there in a little bit, but I want to invite you guys. If you guys are down to roll, when you guys get off air, I don't know. I'll give you directions when we get off air. So
we're there, dude.
Did you say by Taft High School?
Yeah.
Dude, I grew up right over there. That's funny.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I'm right in the area right now. I like to go to a lot of when I find out whenever there's a high school party that they're going back to school, dude. I always find out where the fuck it is and it's a pound of little girl's vagina. It's so fun.
Who brings the blow? The moms or the daughters?
Usually the daughters have it, the moms don't know,
right.
and then once I get a hold of it, then I'm partying with it, and then I give it to the moms, and it's over. And again, if like, you know, who gives a shit? Like if I say I'm partying like until like 5 a.m. and I can't get a boner, dude, right. Then because of all the blow, then that's when the shocker joins the party.
We have lots to talk about when it comes to the shocker.
Let's do it.
Well, first question we just wanted to throw at you, because it's a standard here in the Used Bin. Other than STEEL PANTHER, what have you been listening to lately? What have you been rocking out to in your stereo?
You know what I've been listening to? Do you know a band called Danger Danger?
Sure.
Okay, well, I've been listening to that a lot because we were starting to work on our next record, and so I want to get influenced by that. I've got some Sleazebees in my cassette.
Nice.
And I've also got. I'll go back and forth. Dangerous Toys, I'll listen to that a little bit, and then what I'll do to get some of the newer shit in me. The latest Bullet Boys is what I've been listening to.
Is that record good? Is that a good record?
It's a good record. I like, you know, they don't have any of the classics like Smooth Up In Here or anything like that on it. I don't know. Like I said, I'm trying to be a little more creative and stay up to date. So I'm listening to a lot of the later stuff, like the Danger Danger. The Naughty Naughty was a great. We used some of those licks and some of that some of that shit in there. But we're, like I said, we're starting to write for the next record already, and we're going to be doing a Christmas song. So
that's going to be great.
Yeah, we're probably going to record that at the Palms in Las Vegas. That'll be bitching because we do a show in Vegas every Friday night there at GVR Green Valley Ranch there.
Nice.
And then next week we won't because we're going to Europe.
Nice.
We sold out four shows in like 13 minutes. Well, we sold in... it's going to be bitching. And then we go back and do a ZZ Top show at Wembley Stadium, and that's
sweet.
Just going to be bananas. Yeah, so...
Sweet.
So we're all excited to do that. But Saturday, when we have a day off, we're going to record a Christmas song for everybody that likes Christmassy stuff and Santa Claus and shit.
Beautiful, beautiful.
I bet that'll be really tender, your Christmas song. You guys are a pretty tender band anyway, right?
Well, we want the kids. You know, I mean, it's something for the kids that you know, all that bullshit reindeer stuff. I've heard all those songs over and over and over again, and I love Santa, and I love all the elves and all that kind of shit, and the guy with the red nose. I'm down with all that. But it's time that we did that STEEL PANTHER does a Christmassy song for Jewish people or for other people out there that don't have Christmassy songs.
And you need to dispel the myth that the reason that Rudolph has a red nose is because of all the blow.
Yes.
Totally the blow. I think that's exactly it. That's why Rudolph sounds like this all the time. Have you ever heard Rudolph talk? Have you ever heard him talk?
It's all fucked up because he's got a deviated septum.
He's ham and cheese all the time. Right. Rudolph, that's why he's the most bitchinest ever reindeer, because his nose is just slammed with blow. And right. And the Christmassy songs, the parents don't want the kids to know this.
That's right.
But it's like Rudolph is just a young buck just trying to get his groove on
and make his way.
Hey, it snows all the time in Rudolph's world.
Yeah, ain't that the truth?
He had his own reindeer games.
Yeah.
If you're just joining us, we got
the other reindeer want to fucking party with Rudolph, but nobody let you know that in those stupid shows.
No, because if he was shooting it, because if he was ended up shooting dope, I mean, those guys would never make it out of the North Pole.
It wouldn't be on TV, and Christmas would be ruined all the time.
That's right.
Nice. If you're just joining us, we got LEXXI FOXX from STEEL PANTHER with us. LEXXI, you just mentioned a couple of bands that you were listening to, like Bullet Boys and Danger Janger, and it made me realize that you guys have been playing since, you know, the early 80s on the Sunset Strip, rocking the nation, and I think a lot of those bands, and some of the bigger bands even, Poison, Jovi, they owe you a huge debt of gratitude because you guys were the pioneers.
Yeah, that's what's funny. I mean, a lot of shit got fucked up, and I don't want to get into it as far as what we were partying a hell of a bunch, and I like it now. I like the way it turned out because now all those bands are out of the way. They're all washed up. They're all fucked up on drugs, whatever the fuck it is. But we were fucked up on drugs. See, now they are. Now it's like, okay, cool. Well, let's let all those, like back in the day, we're like, all those bands are at the top, and it's like, fuck, you know, we were partying, and then all of a sudden it comes out, finally we got a little bit of help, not much, because I'm scoring an 8 in 20 minutes. But what I'm saying is the timing is perfect for us, because all those bands are old and wrinkly, and now with technology and the doctor's office, I can make my face not wrinkly anymore.
Nice.
No, I have to say, you're a handsome bastard.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. I handsome is a word, but I prefer foxy.
Foxy, with three X's.
Yeah.
That's right. Hey, who of those bands all ripped you guys off back in the day?
Well, you know, let's see. As far as looks go, I mean, I started even as young as 13, I really started wearing the pink and then trying to make my cheekbones higher and just by using certain kinds of blush and making my eyes look bluer and bigger with a lot of eye drops and a lot of mascara. So I would say that a lot of bands that just, I don't know about musically because I really don't, I mean, I write a little bit of stuff like I would say, hey, the bass should start here, and then the dude's like, yeah, totally. But I would say as far as ripping us off, for me, it's more or less like the bands like Danger, or right. Brittany Fox or Cinderella, because they started using the makeup exactly the way I did it, and their album covers look bitching, and I'm like, motherfuck. And but what are you gonna do? You know, we had our own issues going on while we were recording this thing, and we got ham and cheese, and our faces started to drop. And
did you guys get in any fights with those bands back then? Like any fist fights around the street?
You know what? Since we didn't break because of turmoil within the drugs, a bunch of shit. We weren't that huge at the time. Now there's some things that are floating underneath the water that those, you know, now a little bit, because those bands think that we're ripping them off, or they say that we're ripping them off, but I think they all know. If you've seen it behind the music, then you know exactly. Sure. Like with James and all right. those guys. I mean, right. at least Navarro has the balls to step up and let the whole community of the world know that he at least he's being honest
sure.
about it. You know, a lot of other bands don't want to admit it, you know, so
right.
you know, I mean, I would say to answer your question, the people that ripped us off the most are the bands that look the bitchinest.
Right.
Most bitchinest.
And you've been listeners should all go to steelpantherrocks.com, where you can watch that behind the music.
Yeah.
And you know, you were mentioning the makeup. There's a rumor that's long been around Steel Panther that the makeup actually started because when you were like 12 or 13, you used to raid your mom's makeup.
You know what? Listen, and a lot of people give me a hard time about that, but I'll say this. Hold on, I'm gonna light this joint. Hold on 1 second. I gotta get ready for this.
Fire that fucker up.
Mm.
Fire that fucking thing up.
Mm.
Attaboy. Yeah. Yeah. Hit that shit. Hit that shit like a man.
A lot of people were saying that a lot of dudes think that that's like not cool to go through your mom's closet and shit like that, or put your mom's makeup on and shit like that when she's at work. Can you give me one second?
All right, sure. Attaboy.
Oh, those kids are in for it, dude. a lot of dudes are like, give me one more sec. Totally sorry.
No, that's okay.
Give me 2 seconds. I'm going to set the phone down. I'm going to set this phone down. 1 second. Hold on.
You handle your business.
Sorry about that. A lot of dudes want to say, hey, you know, dudes are bummed on that. But you know what? Chicks fucking totally dig a sensitive looking dude. And now we're bringing back that time where the prettier you look, you know, dude, I get laid all the fucking time. Tonight, I'm going to call you guys back if you guys are still on the air, or uh-huh. you guys are at the party or whatever. I'm going to call back this way, and I'm going to show you. You're going to talk to bitches that'll be like, oh my God, you're so pretty. Oh my God, you're so pretty. And now who's laughing? I got makeup tips from watching my mom when she got early from work. When she would get ready early in the morning from work, I would sit and watch my mom put her makeup on, and I'm like, Ma, you're pretty and stuff. And then dad, well, it wasn't dad, it was whoever was sleeping with my mom at the time,
right.
would just like hit me and tell me to fucking move and shit.
But Lexi, I'm sorry, really quick, did you ever wear her clothes too, or was it just makeup?
Would I ever wear what?
Her clothes? Were you like put on her dresses?
A little bit of them, I wouldn't put on a dress or anything like that. But like sometimes I had bitchin' blouses, and I would just take the bitchin' like red or pink blouse, and what I would do is just fucking cut off the buttons at the bottom and tie it around my waist.
Oh, creative.
Fuck.
That's pretty sexy. That's pretty sexy.
Dude, it's badass. And plus, I'm you know, I was really skinny, so it shows like, and you don't want your pubic hair to show. So I would shave
sure.
my pubic hair. Well, when I was really young, I didn't have to shave. But I mean, now and now I have to shave, because if I don't, I look like a mushroom in tall grass. Down. I gotta keep it trimmed.
Right.
Nice. Right. Well, speaking of being well groomed and sexy, you know, a lot of bass players in bands like Steel Panther would treat the crowd to a boring bass solo, but you've got something unique that you've been working on for a while, and you've got the only hair solo in the business. How did that come about?
Thank you. Here's what it did. The guys were like, first we were at a rehearsal area, and they were like, dude, do a bass solo. And then one of them was joking, and the other one wasn't joking, and one of them wanted to just fuck with me and be mean to me. And it was it wasn't all that good. It was boring. Everybody, nobody cared about it. But then they go, well, what do you do? I mean, what do you, okay, Lexi, you know what? Then how are we going to, what are you good at? And I'm like, well, come on, look at me. And then so they go, because I'm all tan, because what I'm good at is being tan. I'm very good at going to the tanning booth. I'm very good at putting makeup on, and I'm very good at conditioning my hair. So
sure.
They were like, dude, look, watch this. Because there was a fan blowing on me, because you notice I have a fan on me all the time, because it like in all the bitchin' videos, there was always a bitchin' fucking fan blowing and making you look foxy. So if you slow that down, or have you seen our video community property?
Sure,
or,
yeah, of course,
yeah.
Yeah. Well, there's like, or any of the bitchin' videos, there's always wind and shit. And since they can't windy, can't windy in a club, I was like, because first we tried it, and I was hoping that we just left all the doors open,
right?
And
in the club?
Wasn't. Yeah, there's still, yeah, at a club, and there still wasn't enough wind to make me look foxy enough. So they go, dude, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna just blow on you. At first, I was like, get out of here! Get out of here. But then they were like, no, not like that. I'm like, so then they just go, check this out. And I'm like, you know what? This, I'm really good at this.
Nice.
Just standing there, letting those guys blow on me.
Yeah, no, it's really good. Well, one more question about the live show too. Why doesn't Satchel ever let you sing? I was kind of pissed off about that. I was pissed off for you.
Thanks for being pissed for
sure,
me.
Dude,
like,
I got
you
back.
Oh yeah, he always goes in front of my microphone and tries. I don't think because he knows I have a
beautiful. Dude, nice.
I know.
Fucking
and
beautiful.
He likes to do that to just be mean to me and stuff sometimes, and he sometimes will do it to Michael too, and I don't know. He just does it to just he's like a peacock.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
but except he doesn't have feathers. What he has is a guitar and elbows, yeah. And he nudges me out of the way sometimes.
He's kind of a dick, right? I don't know the guy, but yeah, I don't know him. Yeah, I just thought it was. I thought it was pretty fucked up. In fact,
he was hitting on my mom not too long ago. So yeah, that kind of bummed me out.
Hey, you have to hide the moms and the kids, because it's either way. Just like tonight when I go to that fucking party,
atta
I'm
boy.
Gonna tear the shit. Ooh.
Let's talk about the shocker, man.
How did you guys invent that? It's the greatest invention in metal, by the way, since spandex.
Well, we didn't invent it. One time we were like, here's what happened. We all noticed that, and none of us wanted to admit it, but after partying, like as much as we do, when you're doing blow or whatever the fuck you're doing, or being too drunk or whatever, so we would sit there, and one time we were in this mansion, and all of us fucking went, and we were like bummed out. We were all high and fucking high and stuff, and then we met downstairs in the kitchen. It's like, what's going on? I go, dude, nothing. None of us wanted to talk about it. We couldn't get a heart on. We finally all admitted that we were chasing the gerbil, and we couldn't get it to work, you know. And so, since we were in the kitchen, I went to there's popsicles in the freezer, so I grabbed a popsicle stick, and I taped the popsicle stick around my penis so it would stay straight.
Right.
And then I went upstairs.
Of course,
and
naturally.
That bitch was pissed off because she got splinters on her vagina. And so that when I came back downstairs, I'm like, this isn't going to work. Then Satchel and Michael were like, dude, what if you just ram something in there? So I started ramming different stuff, and
good
I couldn't
thinking.
Find anything good enough. Dude, exactly.
Right. They're very creative.
That's exactly. Oh, totally. But those guys are really, really, really smart when it comes to things that I'm not smart at.
Right. You know? So the shocker is, for those of you that don't know, it's two in the pink and one in the stink. And right, isn't that right?
It's metal.
You're
with,
totally
with
right.
an extra
that's
finger.
Called the shocker, and we have a song. Two in the pink and one in the stink.
You know, man. Every time I hear
the shocker,
every time I hear you sing, I just want to say fuck Satchel.
Yeah, dude. Next time you're at our show, tell Satchel, say, fuck you, dude. Fuck you. You should hear me sing. Sometimes I'll do like a new wave song. Sometimes I'll sing Rebel Yell.
Nice.
A
like, new wave song, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, sometimes I'll do that. That's just like, that's new wave is for pussies, but I mean, it's I'll sing it because, you know, it's like I go and sing.
Oh, there you go. Man it up.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
We're talking with.
In the midnight hours, you got more.
Yeah.
Nice.
Fuck Satchel.
Yeah, I know.
We're talking with LEXXI FOXX from the legendary Steel Panther. And speaking of your show, LEXXI, like I said, we were there last night, and I have to personally apologize because we meant to hit Kentucky Fried Chicken on the way over because I know how much you like chicken in the front row.
What chicken? Well, sometimes the whole thing that came about, they all make fun of me for it. But what happens is Michael will say, "Hey, dude, I want to fuck that chick in the front row," and he talks so fast sometimes because of the blow that. And sometimes it confuses me, and I'm trying to pay attention to what he says all the time. So sometimes, and I'm not goofing, and this is, some people make fun of me for this, but sometimes, one time there was a chicken in the club. It happened. It was a long time ago. So now the joke is that I think there's always a chicken in the club, and it's just, you know, not a chicken club, but a chick in the club. And so now if he says, "Dude, I want to fuck that chick in the front row," what? Really? I'm thinking, is there always going to be a chicken when he says that at the shows? And the chicken was a mean chicken. It kept pecking at girls' feet. And I like girls' feet. If they're good feet, I like girls' feet.
Sure.
And stuff. So nobody wants a chicken pecking on anybody's feet. Hey, that's why I'm saying, what chicken? Let's get it out.
Right. speaking of your singer, Michael Starr, he's got this crazy resemblance to David Lee Roth. Have you ever seen the two of them in the same room together?
I have not seen them in the same room together. I have not. Mm-hmm. They actually went out to eat one time. They had dinner together, and oh my God, if I could have seen that. But they did, and Michael doesn't talk about it much because I guess that David wasn't talking to him or something, so he didn't want to talk about it that much. But he does. He looks. But he had some things done.
Oh, okay, sure.
To make me look like a certain person. I'm not going to say what person it is.
Right, sure, no,
I'm going to say that, but maybe the initials are...
DRL? DLR?
Well, I have to see the word. I don't know. I have to see the whole word.
That's okay. No, don't worry about that.
Personally, I don't know if I could handle seeing him in the same room. It would be like too much metal for me. My head would explode.
It would be too much metal and too much ego.
Yeah.
There would be just, the room would probably go, "Oh my God, we don't have enough." The room, if the room would be able to talk, the room would go, "Oh my God, the heads are too big. Now we have to get a sunroof in the room because everybody's head is too big in the room, and there's just maybe those two in there."
Nice.
Wow.
Yeah.
That would be a serious party. Now, if you were partying with those two one night, say at the Rainbow or something, would you rather be doing blow off their mom's vaginas or off their boobies?
The vaginas. I'm not a booby guy. I like those guys like big boobs. That's why Satchel and Michael wrote a song called Big Boobs.
Right.
And me, if I was gonna write a song that was bitching, it would be I like bitching ankles and toes and legs and a nice ass, and you have to be skinny song. You know,
that's perfect. That's
nice.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, but I brought that up, and I guess Satchel couldn't do a guitar part over it. So that's one thing I want to work on.
Somehow. You know, if that guy would let you fucking sing, maybe you could learn to play guitar.
Yeah, see that. Yeah.
You could save that one for the LEXXI solo project.
Hey, we're all going to be doing that too in the future. We're going to have our own little solo records. Do you remember Kiss?
Sure, of course. Yeah.
Well, they had back when we were just starting out. They had all after I think it was Dynasty. They all did solo records,
right.
And that was the best idea in the whole world because their faces on. Look, I know that I would sell more records than the other three dudes in the band. I was going to say Bozo.
Just based on the cover alone. Bozos. Just based on the cover art.
Sell more records just because girls would have a big bitchin' album to hang on their wall.
Right.
Who cares
right.
what it sounds like? You know what? I wouldn't even have to do anything. I wouldn't even put a record in there. I would just do. I would do a photo shoot, and I would just. It would be all pictures in the whole fucking thing. And I'll bet you I would sell more records, and then maybe I'd sing Rebel Yell on it.
Totally.
Well, if you're just joining us, we're talking to LEXXI Steel, bass player for Steel
LEXXI Fox.
LEXXI Fox. I'm all fucked up now. LEXXI Fox from Steel Panther.
For the party.
I know, dude. I'm all excited. Hey, the record is Feel the Steel. It comes out October 6th, and we're pretty pumped to hear. We played a couple of cuts from it here on the show, and the response.
You guys have the record? Do you guys have the record?
We have it.
What's your favorite song on the record?
You know, I got a couple of favorites. When we're done, actually, we're going to play Asian Hooker for our listeners.
Awesome.
But last week we played Girl from Oklahoma, which you guys did a beautiful version of last night. Actually,
do you hear me sing then?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's because Satchel was fucking staring at someone's boobs.
And his guitar had a cable on it. So,
they reeled him in.
Come over to the mic and cock-block me.
Nice.
It's pretty funny.
Nice. So, then you're also on tour. Like you said, you do every Monday night here in Hollywood. And you're in Vegas every Friday and Saturday?
Friday and Saturday night, yeah. We're there at Green Valley Ranch, which is just 10 minutes off the strip. I hope nobody's scared of just going, oh, my God. It's a room that's built for us. They built a stage for us. It's amazing.
Wow. Nice.
And it's packed all the time. And then we play Aliante, which is a little bit farther on the strip. It takes more time to get there. I wanted to fly there, but the other guys were like, dude, you're being fucking stupid. We can't fly there. And it takes a long time to drive. It takes, like, probably about 25 minutes from the strip to get there at Aliante. Yeah, but it's cool too. The stage is amazing, and believe it or not, I'm stoked to see it all the time. It's packed just like it is at Green Valley Ranch, even though we're playing not that far apart from each other. So if you get a chance here in Vegas and you don't want to hang out at those stupid Tao, fucking stupid sun, stupid crap, fucking dumb, what is it, whatever, the Luxor, whatever those dumb clubs are that are on their stupid strip. Our strip here in Hollywood blows their strip away just because we're playing on it.
Absolutely.
We like to go to the outskirts because all that gay shit like fucking Bette Midler and Sonny and Cher, whoever the fuck plays on that strip, then fuck those guys. I don't want to be in that. I don't want to be on that stupid strip.
That's what we're talking about.
We go to the outskirts and we, like the rappers say, keep it real.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of the outskirts, the other thing we should mention is you guys just got back from a big tour, and you played in Europe, or in England, right?
We did. And we're actually going back there next Thursday, and like I said, I was telling you earlier in the interview that we're going back, and our record is doing, we're all so freaked out. Well, we're not freaked out by it, but a little bit, because those people are so far away.
Sure.
And every show that we've done has just been, I mean, our record is a low number there. I don't know what number it is, but we're really, really, really doing good there. And we're on a bunch of bitchin' TV shows, and we're doing bitchin' in Japan, too, because our record released there, over there, 2 months ago. Uh-huh. So all those people, I don't know why our record label did that,
You had a whole song dedicated to Asian hookers, so that was part of the demographic.
Yeah, so maybe that's it. Maybe if we would. Well, we wrote "Girl from Oklahoma" too, but either way. So we go back over there Thursday, and we are so stoked. We're also, like I said earlier, we're playing with ZZ Top at Wembley Arena or Wembley Stadium. I don't know, but it's just us and ZZ Top. That's gonna be fucking great. We're so excited for that.
Well, that begs the really serious question of the night, which is: European vagina or American vagina?
I will take it to the. Okay, if you're just talking about vaginas, all the vaginas like look the same. Like if you just go, if they're skinny, they have to be really, really, really tiny. And if you look from their belly button down, the vaginas all look the same. They all look the same. Is this going to Europe? Are people in Europe going to hear this?
Worldwide.
Okay. The only thing. all right. Then I would say, as long as they don't talk a lot, all the vaginas look. Not the vaginas that talk. That's silly. But as long as the head on the vagina doesn't talk, then a lot. Because sometimes if they start talking about modeling or whatever, I take a piece of rope and I just. No, I don't do that. I like all kinds of vagina as long as they're tiny little girls that just don't talk and that are really fucked up. It's awesome because the more fucked up they are, the more shit you can do.
Beautiful.
Don't want to party with a girl who's like sober and like makes like smart decisions and choices and shit like that.
Another bitchin' thing
you could do if some girl won't drink or do your blow or smoke your weed or fucking take pills, then there's a little pill that some guy invented a long time ago. And I guess it makes the girls totally, like, they don't even know what the fuck's going on. Numb as fuck. They have no idea where they are or anything. And that's kind of cool.
That is totally cool. And you started to talk about that last night, and there was that fucking Satchel guy again. Shut me up. That's a great idea.
It's a great idea.
As long as you don't catch an SUV.
No, you can't. You can't run that fast.
No.
Right on.
I know now that it's a truck and not a sexually transparent, whatever.
Sexually transparent.
Satchel probably right. told you that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
We need to. I think maybe that we need to get you two both on the air together, and we need to work this out.
To duke it out.
Let's work this out.
Where are you guys?
We're here in LA.
We're in Culver City.
Culver City. That's what I thought. I thought it was down there. So yeah, listen, one time we have to do something. We got to go to the studio and do an acoustical thing.
Absolutely.
Oh, now the difference is that we bring wooden guitars, not the metal ones, not the heavy.
I see.
It won't be painted like bitching colors. They'll be just all regular woody.
But before
and
we'll do
an acoustic thing. Wouldn't that be neat?
That would be neat.
But before we do that, I think that we need to have a therapy session. We need to mediate with you and Satchel, because the fact that he doesn't let you sing says to me that there's some control issues there that probably need to be worked out.
Then you know what? Then that's how we'll set it all up. You guys can be the marinators, and then we'll just sit there and just go, okay, well, hey, here's what the marinator says.
We want this. This is for the long term health of the band.
Right.
Thank you.
I mean, we give a shit. I don't care what anyone else says. We care.
Sometimes, I appreciate that. I think Styx does too. Styx is like, dude, what was going on? And I'm like, it doesn't matter, dude. I look bitching, dude. Who cares?
Right on. This has been so fun. Thank you so much for joining us.
I thank you guys so much for playing our record and for getting us out there as much as you guys can. It really means a lot to us. And anytime you guys want to do another interview, just call me when there's not a party that's going to be fucking happening right now.
Right.
Pounding little girls.
Right.
And then old ladies' vaginas. What's bitching about that is if they're really, really young, they don't get pregnant. If they're really, really old, they don't get pregnant.
Nice.
Vaginas don't work. What sucks is if you get like a middle girl, then their vaginas are working like crazy. And you have to be really careful.
See, that's cool. You guys have thought this through, and I respect that.
Yeah.
So we want to make sure you have a great time tonight at the party. We're going to talk to you soon. But before we let you go, we have three rapid-fire questions we always hit everybody with in the used bin. So here we go. What was the first record you ever bought?
First record I ever bought. Michael Jackson, Off the Wall.
Nice.
Good record.
Good call. If you weren't rocking the nation with Steel Panther, what else would you be doing for a living?
Probably doing hair or makeup somewhere.
Of course,
something like that. Or just being probably doing my modeling career, which is what I want to work on as soon as we're done with this tour.
Right.
I want to start doing some modeling.
Sure.
That's
going to be extremely lucrative for you. Absolutely.
I don't know what he's lucrative. He's a rapper.
That's right.
Yes. I don't know what that meant.
And the last question of the night, which is going to be a little bit off the wall for you, but if you were trapped on a desert...
Off the wall, yeah.
If you were trapped on a desert island and you could only bring one Rush album with you, which would it be?
Oh my God, I would just suffer on that desert island with no music then.
Dude, that is
probably the ugliest bass player I've ever seen. Ugly people. I don't even understand it, because they do songs that sometimes I'll like be shaking my head to it, and then all of a sudden they do something crazy and it doesn't make any sense to me. So I don't even know one Rush song.
See, if only Geddy Lee had the foresight to raid his mom's makeup when he was young, they might have a future.
Maybe they'd be fucking huge. You know, maybe they'd be popular.
Right.
I mean, maybe they would sell records, or like our record label says, units. I mean,
units. What's a unit?
So you know what? If Rush, if he would have done that, then I could. Then at least I could have said an album I would listen to.
So you're not going to listen to them because they're ugly.
Again, I always judge a band by their album cover. So
sure,
I didn't see one bitchin' album cover that they ever did. So
fuck them.
Fuck them.
Makes perfect sense.
If you look at the album cover, it looks bitchin' as hell. And if anybody's stupid enough to walk by that and not buy it just because of how bitchin' we look, then you're just gonna be stupid your whole life, your whole stupid life.
That's true.
Damn right.
So listeners, don't be stupid. Pick up Steel Panther as soon as it comes out. Check him out at steelpantherrocks.com.
LEXXI, thank you so much, man. Enjoy the party and go get fucking laid.
I will. And also our MySpace page, too. They can check that out also.
Right.
There you go.
You got it.
And you can do it on a computer. That's the only way you can do those things.
MySpace isn't your house? You don't want them to come to your house? I thought MySpace was your house.
Yeah.
They don't go to your space?
They go... I don't know...
It's a computer.
I don't understand what you said. It's on the computer. That's where they have to go get it.
Go do blow.
You guys, thank you so much. My ride is here right now.
Go rock out, man. Talk to you soon.
I'll talk to you guys soon.
Later.
Later.
Bye.
So there you have it.
Oh, man, I'm fucking tired. Oh, my goodness. That's like a workout.
Yeah. That was good fun, right?
My head is spinning still.
Whoa. We got a whole situation going on.
Man, that was a lot of fun, man. Who's a rock star.
Yeah. Well, you know, he's one of the biggest rock stars around right now. What can you say?
Yeah, you have to go, if you're not familiar with Steel Panther, you need to go to the website, steelpantherrocks.com. It is so much fun. And Joe and I talk about this all the time, about a band that totally gets it. Like a band that knows how to have fun and a band that gets the joke. And these guys are, they're the epitome of a band that gets it.
Yeah.
That's what makes them so much fun. They're silly. The songs are great. Last night they played, what did they play? Rocky Like a Hurricane. They played
some Journey, Stop Believing.
Journey,
they did a bunch of Halen.
Yeah,
they
did so much fun.
They did some Jovi. And, of course, they did a bunch of their originals.
Right. And so it just makes it a lot of fun. So if you haven't seen them here in Hollywood or in Vegas, you need to go check it out. Go to the website. Go to the MySpace.
And, because you'll love them. Your mom will love them. And especially Asian hookers love them. So we're going to hit you with a little bit of that right now. So here is some Steel Panther, ladies and gentlemen.
I try to score some blood, but I don't speak a chop. Hi, I'm Debbie Gibson, and this has to be the silliest show I have ever heard.
Welcome back to the Used Bin.
Welcome back.
Nice to have you. It's, boy, I needed that 3 minutes to just regroup. Like, that's like a lot. I was sweating. So thanks again to LEXXI FOXX for that fabulous interview. And now it is that time of the show where we are going to educate you with a little bit of the
music news.
So, extra pinball bonanza.
Rach.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm sweating. I'm camping. I'm on location.
Oh, that's right. I forgot to mention that Rachel's in the field.
I'm in the field.
That's right. Where are you guys at now?
We're at Lake Sussex. It's right before Santa Barbara.
Uh-huh.
And, oh, my gosh.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Well, I'm glad you guys aren't burning up with the fires. No fires up there, right?
No fires up here.
Good.
Good.
Good, good, good. So, what's going on?
Well, first, first, I wanted to make a suggestion to anyone out there who loves music.
Which is everybody listening to our show.
There should be everyone listening. Go out there, go and see the new music documentary, It Might Get Loud, starring Jack White, Jimmy Page, and The Edge. It's awesome.
Was it great?
It was great. It was great. And there's no acting involved. It is, you know, strictly a documentary, and they're basically just talking about their personal experiences with their journey through being a guitarist. And it's entertaining. It's humorous.
Nice.
It doesn't let you down. It flows really well. There's never a dull moment. And it's funny because in the audience, there's all ages, and everyone, you know, laughed at the same time and walked out with a smile on their face, so go see it.
Does Jack White fit in that group? I always wondered. I always thought he was, like, the odd guy out in that threesome.
You know, I think they have a lot of respect for him. I think he's really amazing, personally, and he's super funny. So he really kind of carries the movie. So.
Oh, okay. Oh, cool. All right, we'll check it out.
And I thought, since I was talking about music movie news, director of The Great Rock and Roll Swindle and The Filth and the Fury, Julian Temple, is making a film about the Kinks called Kinkdom Come, and it's due out in 2010.
Cute.
Oh, that's cool.
Cute. I'm a big fan of those two earlier films that you mentioned. The Swindle is one of the sure. great music parodies long before there was Spinal Tap.
Yeah.
And The Filth and the Fury is the definitive movie if you want to know about the Sex Pistols. So he does a good job, and he gets into his subject matter.
I remember,
look forward to that.
I remember asking Steve Jones one night about
such a name dropper. I was talking to Jonesy one night.
I should. I'm sorry. Let me clarify. Jonesy was talking to me. Mm. How's that?
Okay.
Better.
Sure.
Anyway, but I asked him. It was right around the when everybody was doing a Behind the Music, and I asked him if they were going to do a Sex Pistols Behind the Music, and he said not a chance because the real story will come out in the new movie.
Yeah.
And so they were real.
And that was
a point to do that.
And that was The Filth and the Fury.
Right. Yeah. I'm looking forward to the Kinks movie. That's kind of a cool deal.
Yeah. Totally.
There's a lot of turmoil there with the brothers always fighting. So,
nothing wrong. Speaking of brothers fighting,
yeah,
quite a few.
Oasis,
yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
What about that?
Well, you know, and it's like really not news. It's not surprising.
Right.
They're always fighting, but.
We'll
see if he stays out of the band.
Yeah, sort of surprising, though, that they're broken up now. I mean, I know that they've had their issues, but they've never officially called it quits. I'm not saying that it'll last past next week.
Yeah,
but.
even at points where, you remember when they did, like, the MTV Unplugged, one of the guys just sat it out and sat up in the balcony and got drunk,
right?
Got loaded during his brother's show, right?
Liam,
So, I mean, it's weird that they would actually split it up.
I've just never seen, and now, right, officially kind of do it. And I like the story behind it, which is that Liam showed up to the gig separately in Paris, I guess, and he was drunk when they got to the show, and Noel was pissed, and they got into an argument, and he threw a guitar at Liam, and then Liam grabbed the guitar and smashed it, and then started saying all sorts of horrible things about Noel's kids, and that was it.
Well, I guess, you know, that's when you cross the line.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
So that's crazy, but I just find it to be nutty that that they actually officially called it quits. So, oh well, so be it.
So what else is going on in the music news?
Well, Velvet Revolver drummer Matt Sorum will be touring with Motorhead, and he's filling in for Mickey D while he's off doing the Swedish version of TV's I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, Mickey D will he'll play on the first and the last shows on the tour.
Yeah, and Matt Sorum will play with anybody, apparently.
Oh, dude. Talk about guy drums just, for hire.
The guy just needs a gig. You know, the interesting about Matt Sorum, you know, he's a pretty solid drummer, I'll say that.
Sure.
But you know, at this point, I don't identify him as the drummer for any one particular band.
Nope.
You can't say, you know, like Slash will always be the guitarist for Guns N' Roses, no matter what band or side project he's in. But Matt Sorum is just, well, he's just that guy that plays drums for everybody.
He's the hired gun.
Yeah.
It's crazy, too, because it's not like he's been with little bands.
Right.
He's with the Cult in their
height. The Cult, G&R, Velvet Revolver.
It's just crazy. I mean, he's really been...
Slash's Snake Pit.
Yeah. He's been around for a long time, and he's played with high-profile stuff. And he's, you know, when he comes on stage, you know who he is. Like, the average person knows Matt Sorum.
Right.
It's not like your regular old drummer for hire.
Right.
Like, most people probably wouldn't know Josh Fries if they saw him, although Josh Fries is the same thing.
Right.
He's played with a bunch of high-profile bands, but Matt Sorum's got his own clothing line now, and he's in the spotlight a lot.
Yeah.
So,
true.
Makes sense that he's playing with Motorhead, I guess.
Gotcha. Very good.
That's
very
a good story. Do you have one more for us?
Well, Ronnie James Dio is going to revise his band Dio, do 7 dates British tour in November.
Really? Well, interesting that we're playing a little Dio in the background.
That's right.
Hang
good
on.
Timing.
Hang on. Little Ronnie James there. So that was so that was timely. So he's reforming Dio. So does that mean Heaven and Hell is on hold, or
it just temporarily? So
okay,
he's just filling the void, we'll say.
Tony's
into the void.
That's right. Tony's getting his wrong Sabbath.
Yeah.
Tony's getting his hand surgery, I believe, and that's when Dio's going to play some shows.
Do you know? Do you know who he's either you or Rachel? Do you know who he's going to get in the band? Is it going to be like the Craig Goldie years revisited?
I don't know.
I don't know. That's a good question.
Who was the last in that band? Was it
No, I think the last tour we saw, Craig Goldie was back, I think.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Wasn't that like...
We have to look
that
up.
Was that Magica? Wasn't that the last
that was
tour
a long
he did?
Time ago.
Yeah, but I think that was the last tour he did.
He's got records out after that, that he's toured.
All right, maybe I'm wrong. What do I know?
No, I'm just saying. I wonder. I think... You know, I don't know. I know Jeff Pilson was playing with him for a while. And
he was playing with your mom, too, but that doesn't necessarily mean he's in the band.
No, he was in the band.
Okay, fair enough.
Was.
All right, take it easy over there.
I think Whatchamacallit was in there too. What's his name? From World War III. The guitar player for World War III.
Was that, I don't even remember. Was that Mandy or no?
Is that Mandy Lyons?
Mandy Lyon? No, he was a singer.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Tracy G or something.
Oh.
Something
that
like
could
that.
Be. All you fans who know what we're talking about, call us, 310-840-4438, and school us on the Dio solo band.
I'm actually curious. I'm going to look that up. I'm curious to know who's back in that band. He usually puts together a pretty good band.
Yeah, and I don't want to be the last in line to find out who's in the lineup.
No, but believe me, there's no Dio band if Claude Schnell is not in it.
That's right.
Because Claude Schnell is maybe the king of all Dio keyboard players.
Once you go Schnell, you never go back.
I'm right.
Unless there's Gall. Oh, we don't want to go down that road.
We're going one night without talking about
okay.
that fucker.
All right. Rachel, pleasure as always. Thank you for enlightening us with the music news.
Yay!
Have a safe trip home.
Oh, thank you.
We'll see you next. Talk to you next week.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. So there you go. That's a little bit of the news. I know there was a lot more to get to, but Joe and I had.
I got one other quick news story that wanted to mention because this is, you know, the kind of thing that Joe would bring up.
Uh-oh.
But today in London, something very special happened in Trafalgar Square, which is actually one of my favorite little spots to go have a coffee whenever I'm in London.
Okay.
In each of the four corners of Trafalgar Square, there's a big statue. Okay? There are, you know, generals and kings and whatever.
Okay.
But one of the four corners, there's no statue on the pedestal. and they've been talking for years about, you know, who they would erect there.
Right.
But what they started doing just a couple of weeks ago is a living exhibition, and people got chosen randomly by lottery to, for 1 hour, around the clock, they would rotate it, so that for 1 hour, you got to stand on that pedestal and speak your mind, do whatever you wanted, and you were the center of attention in the center of London.
Okay.
Well, the guy who did it today...
That's a clever idea,
yeah,
actually.
The guy who did it today is a guy named Richard Loveridge, 38 years old, from Hertfordshire, who's a big-time Marillion fan.
Oh.
And he contacted the band before he did his hour on the pedestal, and they decided they would give him the exclusive for their up-and-coming record, which is going to be called Less Is More, and he got to play it in Trafalgar Square, and a ton of Marillion fans showed up for a free listening party to the new Marillion.
Well, that's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's fun. So, that's a really clever little idea.
Yeah, well, those Marillion boys, they're pretty clever like
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
they're
not
good.
So bad.
You could find a better way of life, you know, at Marillion.com or at Used Bin Radio. So I guess we're going to go to a tune.
Sure.
And if you got anything on your mind, we're going to get back to the Dream Theater topic, tell you a little bit about that show. If you saw the show or you want to ask us any questions about the show, 310-840-4438. Drop us an email, usebinradio@usebin.com. And this was a tune that we heard where Mike Portnoy joined the Zappa Boys on stage.
This is a great Zappa song. This is the epitome of satirical Frank Zappa right
here. Sure, because it's a heartwarming message.
That's right. We'll be right back at Used Bin Radio.
Some of you might not agree, but you probably likes a lot of misery. Think a while and you will see. Broken hearts are for assholes. Broken hearts are for assholes. Broken hearts are for assholes. What you gonna do? Cause you're an asshole.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
I'm an asshole. Maybe you think you're a lonely guy. Maybe you think you're too tough to cry, so you went to the grape just to give it a try. And Dagmar,
without a doubt, the ugliest son of a bitch I've ever seen in my life
was his name.
1, 2, 3, 4.
The whiskers sticking out from underneath of his pancake makeup.
Yeah, he was a beautiful lady.
Nearly drove you insane.
Let's talk about leather.
And so you kissed the little sailor.
Tex Abel, starring in the latest Shepherd production. Sir Richard Pumpelow.
You sniffed the reeking buns of angel.
The tail of a demented bread boffer.
And acted like it was cocaine.
Fine whole wheat loaf.
You were dazzled by the exciting new costume of Coco.
Then on Tuesday night, Caesar's back in town.
In a way you can explain.
Facing off the Holtz Bar tag team
and
grudge match.
And so you work along with Michael.
179 pounds of Samoan dynamite.
Which hit your back and awful spray.
Volcanic hell.
But you came back on Sunday for the gong show.
Thursday, two nights.
But you forgot what I was saying. Cause you're an asshole, you're an asshole, that's right. You're an asshole, you're an asshole, yes, yes. You're an asshole, you're an asshole, that's right. You're an asshole, you're an asshole.
Well, now you've been to the grave, been to the chest. Now I think you know what you are. You're an asshole.
You say you can't live with what you've been through. Well, ladies, you can be an asshole too. You might pretend you ain't got one on the bottom of you. But don't fool yourself, girl, it's looking at you. Don't fool yourself, girl, it's winking at you. Don't fool yourself, girl, it's blinking at you. That's why I say,
I'm gonna ram it, ram it, ram it, ram it up your poop shoe.
Cornhole!
Ram it, ram it, ram it, ram it up your poop shoe.
Fist fuck.
Ram it, ram it, ram it, ram it up your poop shoe.
Wristwatch. Crisco.
Ram it, ram it, ram it, ram it up your poop shoe.
Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your.
What are you listening to? Welcome back to the Used Bin.
Hi, how are you?
Pretty good, thanks.
Hey, one more quick news note.
Hit me.
That I forgot to mention was, I think that we would be remiss if we did not mention the Zach Wilde health issue, which I believe he's got some blood clots going on in his lungs. And so I feel bad about that. I mean, I knew he was a little sick, and I knew they had to cancel the tour, but I didn't realize how serious it was. Apparently, I mean, it's extremely serious.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that it's not...
life-threatening.
Yeah, but apparently it could be.
Wow. Well, that's not good. I mean, obviously, that sheds a little light on why Ozzy's moving forward with a different band.
I think one happened after the other.
Yeah.
I think he decided to move on, and then he got sick.
Something I was reading about that said he has to check into a hospital at least every 48 hours.
Yeah, to get his blood checked.
Right.
I mean...
That's rough.
Yeah. You know what it does, too, is it sort of brings things back into a little bit of perspective without getting too cheesy on everybody. But, you know, I mean, we have a lot of fun on the show where we talk a lot of shit about bands and music and different guys that, you know, overrated and underrated or, you know, whatever it is, stuff like that. But, I mean, we certainly don't want to see anybody sick and don't want to see anybody die. And Zach Wilde's obviously an incredibly talented guitar player, great singer as well. And so I just hope the guy gets better. That's all. I just want to make sure that we mention that, make sure that everybody knew that he was sick and hopefully getting better.
Indeed. Get well soon, Zach.
Yeah. Okay. Back to the show. Fuck everybody. Fuck them all. Fuck them all.
Die, die, die. So, Prog-Nation. So we were talking earlier about what a great time we had at the Prog-Nation show and the new friends we met hanging out, videotaping people in the parking lot, and some of the new listeners who are tuned in tonight even, who have emailed us during the course of the show about what a great experience they had over the weekend.
Yeah.
And so we talked a little bit about Scale the Summit, talked a little bit about Big Elf. We talked just a little bit about the amazing Zappa Plays Zappa set.
What an amazing set.
Yeah, those boys could play.
I was blown away.
And it wasn't all boys, actually. The keyboard / flute / kazoo player.
Trumpet, or a sax player.
Was female.
Yeah.
And she...
Which is normal in Frank's band.
And most she Frank's bands, was serious.
Yeah, Frank's bands in the... you know, in the 70s and 80s, usually had a female keyboard sax player like that.
Yeah.
A multi-instrumentalist.
If you will.
Yes. They were great, though, man. They played some progressive pieces that were unbelievable. I mean, they were like time changes up the ass.
Yeah.
Seriously, like for a while there, I started thinking, my God, they're going to outplay Dream Theater at their own show.
Yeah, that's what you were saying. I
still believe it almost happened.
Almost.
In fact,
almost.
I might go on the verge of saying it kind of did.
You think? Well, there's no... there's certain guys in Dream Theater who you just can't dispute. I think Petrucci is just hands down probably the greatest guitarist out there right now.
For sure.
And although he's the quiet one, John Young, the bass player of Dream Theater, I don't think there's anybody who can hold a candle to what he does.
He's a beast.
Now, Portnoy is a great drummer, mm-hmm. but the guy in Zappa's band, I mean, this is a guy with more jazz chops than prog chops or metal chops. And yeah, on a good day, I think he could probably drum circles around
Portnoy.
Although we love Mike to death. Hey.
Yeah, and he's great.
And we love your robe, pal.
We didn't see the robe.
We didn't see the robe. He always, for those who haven't seen Dream Theater, Mike Portnoy always puts the same bathrobe on at the end of the show. And
it says heavyweight champion of the world.
And it must smell. Yeah. It must be stinky by now.
Yeah.
Maybe he retired the robe.
Maybe.
Yeah.
All I know is that part of the... part of the end of the tour deal was he brought out all four drummers from all, or all three drummers from the other bands.
Right.
And he brought out, so he brought out the Scale the Summit guy who, again,
well, this, like was, okay, so now we're talking about the Dream Theater set. So during the drum solo, which Mike started.
Right. He brought out about, the kid had to have been 18 years old or something. So he came out, because Mike's got the monster drum kit. Monster kit. I mean, it's three kits, you know? And so he brings him out, and they play a little bit together, and he just couldn't keep up. In fact, he dropped a drumstick. He looked nervous. He just looked out of place.
Yeah.
And then he brought up the big elf guy.
But he was having the time of his life.
Yeah, if he wasn't shitting his pants.
Yeah, that's true.
And then I have a hunch he was shitting his pants.
And then he brought out the big elf drummer.
Yeah, who was pretty good. But, I mean, you know, that guy is what he is. He's just sort of a 70s groovy kind of drummer. There's not...
Right.
With the big elf, there's not many a ton of time changes, and it's not real complicated stuff.
Right.
It's really groovy stuff, but it's not real complicated stuff.
Right. So then he brought out Zappa's drummer, and they sat side by side at this monster kit and traded paradiddles and fills. And
it was nuts. It was a pretty incredible... Incredible exhibition of drumming.
Yeah, indeed. And then just to
And I'll say Portnoy got outplayed.
Yeah. And then to top that off, then he brought all four of them out. And so all four of them are working on the same kit all at the same time.
Right.
And at the end, he dubbed it, instead of Prog-Nation 2009, he dubbed it Percussion-Nation 2009, that little segment of the show. So that was cute.
You know, and I'm not a big drum solo fan, not at all.
Right.
The only really drum solo I like is Neil Peart's drum solo. That's really it.
Right.
But at least it made it interesting. Because I know I sat down for a minute when I knew he was going to do a solo, and I thought it was weird because it's an abbreviated Dream Theater set as it is. So why would he waste time during a drum solo? Usually they...
Last night of the tour antics, they were just having some fun.
That was what made it good. But when he initially started and it was just him, I thought, really? In a 90-minute set, you're going to do a drum solo? But then it made sense as everybody everybody slowly came out and did their deal.
I'm going to kick myself later if I don't say this now, so let me just get it out of the way. I'm not a big drum solo fan either, other than, like you said, Neil Peart. But the one exception, and I got to get it out there, is when Phil Collins and Chester Thompson does their drum duet. That's something kind of special. You've seen it.
I saw it. It was cool.
Yeah. So those are the only ones, but I had to get that out.
It's cute because that's a drum duet.
Right.
And that makes it...
And it's all syncopated and choreographed, and it's a cute piece of theater.
Right. It's what makes the end of Neil's drum solo so great.
Right.
When he does the big band stuff and the jazz stuff, and I mean, it's interesting. Tommy Lee's drum solos, too, for the most part, are boring until he starts playing, he starts playing stuff from, like, Led Zeppelin and all sorts of classic rock songs. He starts playing drums too in those solos.
Right.
So at least that makes it interesting. But otherwise, drum solos for the most part, I think, are boring.
Right.
And self-indulgent, and most drummers can't do anything interesting.
Yeah. But this was
great.
This was all about last night of the tour, hijinks, and having
really
fun.
Really fun.
And just so you don't think just the drummers were getting showcased with their chops, later in the Dream Theater set was time for the guitarists to have their spotlight. So Petrucci started with his shredding little solo.
Which, again, I was surprised that they were doing, but I sort of, at that point, you sort of thought something was up.
Yeah, and of course, next, Dweezil Zappa walked out and joined in and turned the solo into a duet.
Who, by the way, Dweezil is a pretty underrated guitar player.
Oh, very much so.
He's
incredible.
He's not one of those guys that like goes out there and just goes, check me out.
Yeah, no, he's not
that guy.
He's not a flashy shredder.
Nope.
He's not Yngwie, but he could keep up with any of those guys.
But he plays within himself, which is what makes him so great.
And he's just smiling and so laid back. And
time of his life.
You know, it's funny how much he resembles his dad on stage, because he's got the same little facial expressions and the same little quirky things about him. But he's never like so intense that he's like shredder guy. Guitar god. He's just so laid back and just doing his thing and having fun.
He doesn't look like he takes everything so seriously.
Yeah, joy to watch.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you get the feeling for the last two or three years that they've been doing this that he's really enjoyed bringing Frank's music to people that probably have never heard Frank or certainly never seen him live.
Right.
So it was really great. And he's pretty fun to watch. So that was a surreal scene.
Petrucci and Dweezil doing a guitar duet. And then, just to make matters more complex, Portnoy looks over to the side of the stage and kind of jokes, who else have we got over there? And out walks Steve Vai.
And which
then
is cool.
Duo becomes trio, and the three of them are just trading leads, going off, going nuts. It was serious guitar shredding prog rock.
And Vai played with, for those of you that don't know, played with Frank for years.
Yeah,
So that made it a little bit more special, seeing Dweezil and Vi together.
As well as a little frontman called David Lee Roth.
Or Mayor McCheese to you, pal.
There you go.
And then, just to make it even more complex, the trio became a quartet, because then Jordan Rudess came out with his weirdly shaped keyboard, guitar, keytar. It's a keytar.
But he calls it like a Zephyr something. That's the official name of it.
Is that the official name?
Yeah.
Okay, so he came out with
pretty amazing.
And so the four of them go off on this just absurd note density quartet of shredding.
And you know what was funny about that? First of all, I think Steve Vai was shocked to see Jordan there, because I don't think they expected him to...
That didn't look planned.
But it was very funny. Very cool. And they got to a point where, you know, Petrucci would do his thing, and then Dweezil would do his thing, and then Vi, and then Jordan. And then they would go back and forth. And it got to the point where Dweezil was like, dude, I'm not the shredder guy. Like, this isn't my deal. I'll play some notes with you guys, but why don't you guys just pull your dicks out and see who's bigger?
Yeah.
And Dweezil almost, like, took a step back. You know what I mean? And so Petrucci would... Dweezil would go... And then and Jordan, and then Dweezil... It's very funny.
That's right, yeah. Petrucci and Vi were basically trying to change the rotation of Earth's atmosphere.
All on their own.
And the density of the sun.
Right, and Jordan wasn't going to be outdone.
And Dweezil was just happy to smile and go, you guys, you nutty guys.
Right. Yeah. It's pretty funny.
So that was good fun.
Yeah.
Let me just rattle off the set list, because...
We haven't even talked about the show.
This was just a monster Dream Theater set. So they opened up with A Nightmare to Remember off the new album, which was great, because they had some cool intro video and they had a whole great vibe. It's got a beefy Metallica kind of riff. If you don't know the tune, you got to go check out the new record.
That was my favorite tune on the record for a long time. Yeah, not anymore, but...
And then they went into another one off the new record. What are we listening to, by the way?
This is Living Color.
This is off the first record?
Yeah, this is a Vivid, yeah. It's one of the cheesier songs that I've ever played on the show.
That's okay.
But I like it.
What was that one song off the Living Color album? Something Boys?
Glamour Boys.
That was a poppy little tune.
I resisted putting that on here because it's a little gay.
It's a little gay.
But listen to how like cheesy this is.
I'm standing in the shadows, baby.
Standing in the shadows, baby.
It's like a Michael Jackson line.
Sure it is.
Standing in the shadows, baby.
Corey's moonwalking right now. In the shadows.
Listen to that bass, though. It's great.
These guys should have been around longer. They should have been around. They hit about a two-year peak or a two-year period where they were really big, and then they just... disappeared.
I thought the record after this, though, wasn't great.
Yeah.
And I thought they didn't put out anything nearly as good since.
Shame, too, because that's a guitar player. I can't remember his name.
Vernon Reed.
Vernon Reed, yeah.
Vernon Reed's
that
a man.
That guy is just insane.
And Corey Glover's a hell of a singer.
Yeah.
He's a great singer.
And a fine-looking man, too.
Fine-looking man. And he was in Jesus Christ Superstar.
Sure he was.
There you go.
So, after Nightmare to Remember and A Rite of Passage, which was epic.
Epic.
Then they kind of slowed things down. We didn't know where they were going because there was a long intro. And they went into what turned out to be a pretty amazing version of Hollow Years.
Yeah.
Ballad to You and Me, but live, a big, big show-stopping tune.
Yeah. It's like a vehicle for them to play a little bit, it seems like.
Yeah. An odd choice after that was, I thought, was Prophets of War, which is a good tune, but, I mean, it was basically stolen from the Muse playbook.
Sure, yeah.
It's got
Muse
that same
queen,
it's got that
Nana.
Same Muse sort of techno beat underneath, and it's very much a Muse song.
Very English.
Not sure why they went down that path, but...
They've been playing that a little bit on this tour, too. I've noticed throughout the set list. I was surprised... Okay, go ahead. I don't want to interrupt.
Okay. So then, one of the highlights for me personally was when they visited 6 degrees of Inner Turbulence.
Of course.
And when they were doing the solitary shell portion of 6 degrees.
Huge.
It was just, you know, it was very, very huge, very large. And they followed that with what basically turned out to be a 45-minute version, really, of Beyond This Life. And Beyond This Life is from Scenes from a Memory, quintessential Dream Theater. It's on the, on Scenes from a Memory, I think it's 5 minutes long, 6 minutes long, something like that.
Yes.
But basically, we got a 45-minute version of it, and the reason for that was because that drum solo that we mentioned earlier with all four drummers happened during that song, and shortly after that, the whole Guitar Nation improv thing happened during that song, and then they came back to reprise Beyond This Life. So, yeah, 45 minutes, right, basically, of that song, and it just went on and on, but in a good way. And
really good.
Yeah, that was certainly the centerpiece of the show.
But now let's get to the
crux,
right,
of what everybody was waiting for.
Let me preface with Count of Tuscany with this.
Yeah.
The encore, by the way.
Yeah.
Visually, I've always said the Dream Theater sort of lacks a little bit. And I'm not talking about the band, like the way they look or anything.
Their production was always just a little dated.
Hair short.
Yeah.
It just falls a little bit short.
Yeah.
I didn't think that was the case this time.
No.
They had a beautiful, beautiful gray backdrop with the big movie screen in the middle, and it looked like it was floating. It looked very three-dimensional.
Yeah. Really, it was really well-produced video for some of these tracks.
Sure. And like gray, little things hanging from the stage, and Mike's John Petrucci's stacks were all painted gray, so everything had like a very moody feel to it because, you know, black clouds and silver linings. I thought visually it was a beautiful show.
Yeah,
really, like I've never felt like that about a Dream Theater show where I go, wow, there you go, like this is the whole package finally.
Right.
And then came the Count of Tuscany.
Yeah, which just to step back, like we mentioned earlier, sometime in the near future on the website, you can check out the Usbin Radio YouTube section, and you will be able to find the clips, the video clips that we took in the parking lot, Prog Rock parking lot, if you will, of Dream Theater fans and Prog fans who were at the Greek Theater for the last show of the Prog-Nation tour. We talked to them a little bit about Dream Theater and Prog in general, and as we were asking everybody what song they hoped Dream Theater would play later that night, it's funny how almost unanimously everybody was like, man, I really hope they pull out Count of Tuscany.
Yeah.
And for a 19-minute long song, after they wrapped up with the 45-minute version of Beyond This Life, I thought, well, they'll probably encore with something obvious like Pull Me Under or something like that. I didn't think they had a 19-minute song in them for an encore, but I was wrong, and they dazzled us.
And they've been closing with that every night on this tour. Man, what a monster.
Yeah.
It is the greatest Rush opening that Rush has never written.
That's right.
And then it just goes into this unbelievable space. We've talked about that song ad nauseum on the show, but I mean, it is live. It was epic.
Yeah.
Perfect. It was really, for a 90-minute set, which is very short for Dream Theater, I thought it was really great. I was a little surprised at Hollow Years.
Yeah. They had to throw in at least one ballad to show their diversity. It was going to either be that or The Spirit Carries On, I thought.
I was just waiting for a big monster show. I really thought we were going to get a lot of notes. And we did get a lot of notes, but you know what I mean. I just thought it was going to be one after the other.
You thought it was
we
going to
get
more,
pummeled.
You thought it was going to be more like Metropolis into Dance of Eternity.
Yeah. I wanted to say this, too, about Dream Theater.
Yeah.
What's funny about them is as we watched all the bands play Scale the Summit, Big Elf,
Zappa.
No, excluding Zappa for a second. But those two bands, and then Dream Theater comes on. It's amazing what a difference it is. I mean, those two bands were a little amateurish compared to Dream Theater. I mean, Dream Theater comes on and it's fucking tight. It sounds perfect. They nail everything. They don't miss ever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It is really good.
If you're just joining us right now, this portion of the show has been sponsored by Dream Theater. Mike Portnoy, we want to thank you for the check.
That's right. Really, it was. I mean, they're in a different class, that band.
Yeah.
And it's very obvious when you see a band like Big Elf and it's nothing against these bands, Big Elf and Scale the Summit. Zappa is just Zappa is sort of a different animal. So I kind of put him in a different place, but production-wise and, just the way those guys played, totally different class.
Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah, I thought they were great. I really was impressed.
So, scale of 1 to 10, Prog-Nation 2009?
Oh, I would say an 8.
Okay.
I was really looking forward to all four bands.
Yeah.
It's not often that I go to a show and I want to see every single band.
Yeah, no, that's true.
And I was really curious.
I would certainly go eight, maybe even 8.5.
Sure.
Because I'm crazy like that.
Sure.
I'm nuts. You can't stop me.
I would have given it an 8.5 had maybe the Dream Theater set been just a hair different.
Yeah.
But that's just me. I feel like when they were here last time for Prognation, we got a similar type of set.
Well,
I think we get hollow years a lot here in LA.
Well, I think, and this is just me overthinking the whole situation, which is what we do here anyway.
Right.
But I think they got to throw something like that in the set because they know there's the remote chance that there's a few maybe Zappa fans in the audience who are turning up who maybe aren't too familiar with Dream Theater, and they got to throw them a melodic bone here and there. Whereas when they go out and they do their full 3-hour production on the All Dream Theater All the Time tour, which hopefully we'll get the second leg of that later this year.
What did you say?
Spring.
I hope that's an evening lift.
Yeah, I would imagine it would be because they generally do Prognation, a 90-minute to a 2-hour set. We got about 2 hours.
Right.
And then when they do the headlining show, it's usually just an evening with.
I hope we get that
three hours.
Did we get that last year, an evening with?
Yeah.
Yeah, they didn't have an opener last time.
Yeah. So
where was that tour?
That was Systematic Chaos.
Where?
Universal. Remember, we saw him at Universal twice. Once was Systematic Chaos, and once was Prognation.
Right.
This segment has been brought to you by Dream Theater. Thanks again, Mike, for the check.
Well, dude, we've been pumping this. We've been talking about this since they announced it. So
yeah,
it's very worthy of this segment.
So Prognation 2009. I guess we get two thumbs up on that. Prognation 2010. Who would you like?
Gonna say.
Who would you like to see? We asked a lot of people that in the parking lot. And real quick, I remember a lot of people mentioned Symphony X.
And Opeth.
A lot of people mentioned Opeth, Porcupine Tree. Although I don't know if Porcupine Tree needs to share a bill at this point with them, but maybe that would be.
I'd like
that
to
would
see
be awesome.
That.
There were a few Spock's Beard mentions.
Listen, I'd like to see Porcupine Tree. I'd like to see a, and I'm sure he's up for it. But I'd like to see a Transatlantic.
Sure,
you know. What I mean?
Sure.
Why not? There's a record coming. New record coming.
You know, of course, I'd love to see Marillion on the bill.
I think they would be great on this bill.
Yeah.
I think the kids would get it.
Who is this?
Kamals. Oh, no.
Oh. Come on, I'm setting you up here. Who is this?
Let me think about that for a minute. Oh, is this Van Halen?
No. Because that's not David Lee Roth.
Right, so this is Van Halen.
No, but that's not David Lee Roth.
Sure it is. Sure it is. This is the cream of the crop, Van Halen.
This is the cream of the crop, Van Halen.
Cream of the crop, baby.
Yikes.
You can tell the difference. There's no cheese. It's
yikes.
Nice.
Yikes.
It's rock with a little edge as opposed to rock with a little cheese.
Oh, no. So, who would you like to see at Prognation 2010?
I'd like to see Marillion on that bill.
Yeah, I think that would
work. And I'd like to see Porcupine Tree on that bill, although they couldn't be on the bill together.
No.
Because you're going to need one of those rock bands on the bill. You know?
Yeah.
Portnoy's a metal guy.
See, I think Symphony X would work. That would be
kind of
similar.
That's the problem. Is they're kind of similar.
Yeah.
So you sort of need like an Opeth kind of ish band.
Yeah.
You know?
That's a good point.
I'd like to see Beardfish back on the bill because they weren't on the bill. They were supposed to be and they canceled. So I think I probably wouldn't mind seeing Beardfish. I'd love to see Transatlantic. If they could pull that off, that would be great.
What about It Bites? Two pop for Prognation?
Well, if you're going to put Marillion on there.
Okay. Well, it's certainly not too...
It couldn't be on the bill if Marillion was on there.
That's true. It might be a little too pop for Prognation, but it's certainly not too prog for the Cal Prog Festival, which is coming to Whittier, California on October 10th.
It's going
to
be fun.
You and I will be there watching It Bites, and that's going to be big fun.
Yeah.
Yep.
I don't know. I'm trying to think if there's... Who could you pull out of your ass like a Zappa plays Zappa? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because that was such a treat.
Well, that's sort of the vibe that Pain for Salvation goes for. Pain of Salvation are a little wacky like that, too. And they were almost on this bill.
I would like to see. So I'm sorry. My brain is working as you're talking.
We're just fanboys geeking out at this point.
I would like to see...
Steel Panther.
A classic prog band on there. Like a Marillion. I would like to see him stick to that.
Right.
You know, because like Zappa Play Zappa was sort of classic prog. Well, it's not really classic.
Well, one guy we talked to before the show that we got on videotape, he had a great idea, and he thought King Crimson. Now, how epic would that be?
Yeah, I'm in with that.
That would be huge.
How about like you know, they wouldn't do it, but like, yes.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, something like that would be cool. I would like to see a classic prog on. That's why I would really, you know, push the Marillion on that bill.
No, indeed.
And Portnoy's a fan, so.
He's a big fan.
Yeah, I would love to see Marillion on that bill. I think that'd be cool.
Yeah, absolutely.
What a great way to reintroduce Marillion back to America.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm in. I think that'd be neat. And then you could do kind of whatever you want. And if you're not going to do Marillion, I'm going back to Transatlantic.
Okay.
Let Portnoy play both sets.
I like it. I like that. That works. Although he's going to play all four sets anyway because it's his show. It's the Portnoy hour, ladies and gentlemen.
That's right up my alley to make fun of. That's the kind of shit that I hate.
Yeah.
I rip apart like that kind of, you know, ego type thing.
But somehow I forgive Portnoy because it's like, you know, do what you want.
The guy had the foresight and the nuts to put together Progressive Nation.
Yeah, the foreskin?
Yeah, and the nuts.
Okay.
To put together Progressive Nation. So he can do whatever the fuck he wants. He could play all four sets. It's all good.
Why has there never been a traveling Prog tour until now? God bless you, Mike Portnoy. God bless you.
He did great. It's great. Someone needs to wave the flag for Prog, and he's that guy right now. So I'm backing it. 100%. If he wants to, that guy could come out and introduce all the bands, and I don't feel like it's ego. I feel like it's promoting. It's for the higher good of Prog.
Know what I mean? I totally agree.
So,
which begs the important question. What are you going to do on Monday for your birthday, pal? Happy birthday early.
Oh, thanks. What am I doing?
We'll get the recap next week, but you got anything planned?
No. I don't have much planned. It's Labor Day, right?
Yeah.
Memorial Day, Labor Day, one of those days.
Here in America, anyway. Some of you
still rocking America.
Some of you internationalists might not have the day off, but we will.
Yes. I don't know what I'm going to do. We'll see what Leah's got up her sleeve.
Okay, so fair enough.
We'll see what she has to do. And that's pretty much it for me, man.
All right.
You know, birthdays to me are...
just a time for cake.
Yeah. It'll be better when it's my son's birthday. I'll look forward to that when it's Babalu's birthday. Happy birthday, Babalu. Oh, wait. What's that?
It's time for the final countdown, ladies and gentlemen, here in the U.S.B.I.M. This is the time of the evening where we like to count down a few of the records that we think you should be listening to.
Do you think...
that was so cheesy.
Do you think that Joey Tempest is jealous of LEXXI FOXX being so handsome?
Isn't everybody? I mean, come on. If I looked like LEXXI FOXX, wouldn't I just, like, stay home and look at myself in the mirror?
Do you think that Satchel...
play with my nuts?
Do you think Satchel would have the balls to block Joey Tempest's microphone?
No.
No. Because Joey Tempest has a big cock.
And what are you saying? LEXXI doesn't?
I didn't say that at all.
Right now, at 9:56 Pacific time, he is knee-deep in teenage poontang.
He's combing the high school right now, dude.
God bless him. Final countdown.
I have no final countdown.
No final countdown? No. So just Dream Theater or something. Or whatever.
Steel Panther.
There you go. That's a good
October 6th, Steel Panther is Feel the Steel. It is a rockin', satirical, fun metal record. Go to the shows if you live in Hollywood, if you live in Vegas, if you live in San Diego. It's lots of fun. So that's my, there you go. That's my final countdown, Steel Panther.
Nice. Well, I got one that's totally out of left field. It's not something we've talked about at all tonight, but it's something that I felt the need to plug real quick. And it's interesting, you just mentioned that we could still rock in America, which you can, but Still Rock in America was never what I thought was a great Night Ranger song. But if you want to hear some truly great Night Ranger songs, go to a record that not a lot of people remember or know about called Neverland. This was sort of their reunion album. This was in 1997,
right.
Not an 80s record. In fact, the last record they had made prior to Neverland was Man in Motion back in 88. But Neverland is a magic little record. You must go check this out. This
Magica.
Is Magica. No, this is some of Jack Blades and Kelly Keegee's finest compositions. I mean, you know, we all remember the cheesy songs from the 80s, and some of them will live forever in our hearts.
A lot of them
and in our loins. But
those are big songs.
Sure,
big
but
songs.
Equally as big, if you check this record out are songs like Forever All Over Again, As Always I Remain, and Someday I Will. Huge, huge songs. So that's my final countdown. Go check that one out.
I'll check it out this week. I'm going to listen to that next week and give you a review. How's that?
Okay, that sounds good.
I've never heard it. Hey, before
And that is my final countdown.
Before we get the hell out of here, a couple of quick thank yous. I want to thank Rich at Pure Rock Radio, Sean Gordon at ProgRock.com, Ernie at the Red Eye Radio Network, Terry Edwards and Max Krasny at Westwind One, Chris Stone and Rob Wilson for working on the Used Bin website. I want to thank LEXXI FOXX for taking a few minutes out of his busy schedule of doing blow and fucking chicks to hang out with us.
And that was asking a lot of.
I know that's
so
a,
we
that's
really.
A big
appreciate that.
Yeah, so we thank you for taking the time to do that. And that's it, dude. I got no more for you.
Beautiful. Well, right. Brother man, it was nice to see you.
And guess what? To see you, it's
nice.
Used Bin Radio. What are you listening to?
You're strapped in to a live radio broadcast on Pure Rock Radio.